Mr. Doug Bolton here, and he's going to be sharing a lot of information on supporting our children through their hardest moments. But before I have him come up here, I do want to just recognize Dana Lautenberger. She is going to actually sketch note this evening, so as Mr. Bolton is presenting, she's going to be drawing and sharing the information via sketch noting, and it's going to be up on the screen. So as Mr. Bolton is presenting, you're going to be able to see a visual and a graphic, which we'll be able to use afterwards. So again, we can't thank you enough for being here tonight to help support all of our students. And I'm going to let Mr. Doug Bolton take it away. He's a retired administrator. He was the principal of a therapeutic day school on the North Shore, and he is just a wealth of knowledge on supporting our children, especially through all of our challenging times. Thank you.
Krista, thank you. So I may just be watching over here, actually. This is so fascinating to me. I love it. I've seen other people do it, and I've never seen it live. So I've seen the results. So thank you for being here. And thank you all for coming out tonight. You know, I think that it's not a secret that our kids are hurting now more than any time that we understand in our history, really. Our kids are unprecedented levels of mental health challenges that preceded COVID. Kids were struggling before COVID. In just a decade before COVID, depression increased in kids by 60%. The number of kids and teenagers seen in emergency rooms with suicidal thoughts or attempts doubled. This is all before COVID. And here's the thing that I think is most frightening to me when we think about how our students are struggling. The suicide rate for kids is 2 times higher when school is in session. What this is telling us is that it's not just the schools, it's our culture that is pushing our kids to the brink of their ability to cope, and for some kids, beyond that. And in September 2019, the study came out saying that students in high-achieving schools are now named an at-risk group. Just attending a high-achieving school puts you at risk. The Robert Wood Johnson Foundation named the top environmental conditions harming adolescent wellness, and we all know poverty, discrimination, and trauma, but there it is, this excessive pressure to excel. There's a pressure our kids feel that they've never felt before in our history, and I think it's important that we begin to understand that. They put it on themselves, we put it on them as parents. Our schools are pushed to push kids harder because we're so invested in being able to make achievement. The focus and our kids are the drivers of that achievement. We get anxious if they don't achieve, that what's going to happen to their future. And then, on top of that, we layer COVID. So there's a public health parable that I find really helpful as I think about the challenges our kids are facing. And in this parable, there are two people having a picnic. We'll say by the Des Plaines River, beautiful Des Plaines River, right? So they're hanging out by the river, and they look up and they see a child in the river drowning. And they jump in and they get that child out, and they're exhausted by the time they get out. And then they look up and there are two more kids floating down, struggling. They dive in and they get those kids. And then they look up and the river is full of these kids. And then one of the adults gets up on shore, and one in the water says, "What are you doing? I can't save these kids on my own." The one on shore says, "I'm going upstream. I want to figure out why these kids keep falling in. That's where we've got to stop this." The thing is that our kids' hardest moments, when it shows up as behavior, it's always a downstream problem. Upstream problems are things like stress and trauma and poverty and successive pressure to excel. Kids who are slower to develop certain skills, discrimination, all of these things. But when we are focusing on behavior, focusing on the wrong thing. And I think the thing that I struggle with the most is I'm a psychologist who, as a therapeutic school principal, I was very much a believer in the power of managing behavior. But what I learned as I explored the research is we've been ignoring really important research for over 150 years that can help us better understand how to help our kids. So I want to talk today about a new way of understanding behavior. So typically our model of behavior is We see behavior through the lens of motivation. If a kid is misbehaving, what we have to do is we got to figure out what is the carrot or what is the stick that's going to help them behave in a different way. But the thing is, I'm motivated to not yell at my kids. But guess what? I've yelled at my kids. Am I the only one? I'm a psychologist. I know it's not a good idea to yell at my kids. I am not motivated to yell at my kids. Why is it that there are times when I do things that are really unhelpful to my family, to myself? And is it about motivation? No, it's not about motivation. So how did we get here? And I want to talk a little bit about the history of behaviorism. John Watson was the father of behaviorism. Early 1920s, he came out with a book, and this book, the second chapter, was titled The Dangers of Too Much Mother Love. Check out what he says. When you're tempted to pet your child, remember that a mother's love is a dangerous instrument which may inflict a never-healing wound, a wound which may make infancy unhappy, adolescence a nightmare, an instrument which may wreck your adult son or daughter's vocational future and their chances for marital happiness. Wow. Do not show affection to your children. But here's the thing. When we say this is ridiculous now, right? But when in their hardest moments, when they're acting up, what do we tell them? What do we say? Don't give them any attention. We withdraw attention then, don't we? Because we're only going to reinforce the behavior. I think that's been a big problem for us for a long time. B.F. Skinner came along. This guy was an amazing scientist. He got rats and monkeys and pigeons and rabbits to do amazing things just by getting them to press the lever and getting the reinforcement schedule right. He said, give me a child and I can shape him into anything. And here's the thing. Behavioral interventions can control our behavior. Put a gun to my head and there's a lot of stuff I'm going to do, right? Trisha, if you offer me an extra $1,000, $2,000, I'll say whatever you want me to say, right? It's not to say that these things don't work. The thing is that there's a cost. And we've got to be thoughtful about the cost. Because the things we do to get the most out of our kids are often counterproductive because what they do is they shut our brains down. Because all that we're focused on then, what's the punishment we're going to get, or what's the reward we're going to get? And we lose focus and engagement on the thing that we're hoping kids will be focused and engaged on. We go from being really thoughtful, reflective, broad thinkers to being focused only on the here and now and what's best for me. I was doing research on this, and I was surprised to see this show up in my own life. I was taking spin classes at the time. Anybody take spin classes? So I take spin. I'm taking a spin class, and we walk in, and there's about 10 or 12 bikes there. And I come in, and my job, I'm an old guy, you know, I just need to get my heart rate up, right? I need to get a little bit of a sweat in, and I got to make sure that I can, don't overdo it so I can still exercise tomorrow. Like, that's about it for me. So I hop on the bike. And the trainer, the person who's leading the class, says, today is a special day. We're going to have a prize for the person with the most watts. And the watts are, whoever works the hardest, and it's measured by watts. And so I look around, and I think, I'm a former athlete. I'm old, but I think I can take these people. So I start biking, and 40 minutes later, there is a puddle of sweat underneath me. I am bright red. They almost need to bring out the paddles, right? I was spent. I couldn't exercise for the next 3 or 4 days. I was just spent and I was sore. There are two embarrassing things that came out of this, besides that, of course. And the first is, I think I came in 8th. I mean, I wasn't even close. And the second was, the prize, the reward, was a sports bra. I didn't even know what I was trying to earn. It didn't matter. Right? My wife was really angry with me. She's like, you lost? Are you kidding me? But here's the thing. This is what happens for us is we become focused only on the moment, even when we know better I think that there was that in our history, in the history of all of this, there were two things that came together. One was Watson's theory, and the other was Henry Ford's assembly line. Because when we don't want people to think, incentives and consequences work pretty well. It works on an assembly line. It doesn't work so well with kids' minds. One of the things that they found is that the kid's brain is a very different thing than a rat's brain or a pigeon's brain. See, what happens is punishments rely on fear and shame, don't they? And with incentives, we do the right things, but for the wrong reasons. We have a lot of, it's good. We know that it's good for kids to read in the summer, right? It's very good. We want kids to read in the summer. It's essential. And so we develop programs to get them to read more. And the good news is, if you incentivize kids to read more, they read more. So we should keep doing it, right? Well, the interesting thing is they began to look a little more closely at the data. And what they found is what kids were doing when they were incentivized to read is they would pick out books with bigger print, with more pictures. When you asked them comprehension questions, they weren't able to answer them as well as the kids who weren't incentivized to read. Here's the other thing, though, that I think is even more concerning to me, is when they followed up with those kids and they didn't incentivize them the next summer, compared to kids who were never incentivized, the kids who were incentivized that one summer reported reading less. And then they also reported enjoying reading less. What Barry Schwartz says is incentives demoralize what is otherwise a moral act. They change a question in people's minds from is this right or wrong to is this worth the price? My hope is for our kids, they can be struggling with right or wrong even when they choose wrong sometimes. Because then it becomes a time that we can teach them. DC and Ryan did all this research. They looked at 128 experiments on rewards. They said careful consideration of reward effects reported in 128 experiments lead to the conclusion that tangible rewards tend to have a substantially negative effect on intrinsic motivation. When institutions, families, schools, businesses, athletic teams focus on the short term and opt for controlling people's behavior, they do considerable long-term damage. We need to think about this. Let's take a look at punishments. Anybody still have kids in daycare? You all have had kids in some sort of daycare, is my guess, many of you, right? So they did a daycare study. In other words, 20 daycare facilities in this organization. And what they did was parents, believe it or not, were showing up late to pick up their kids. And so they said, we want to figure this out. We want to change that. So they said, we're going to fine the parents $5 every time they're late to pick up their kid. They were supposed to pick them up at 6, and they were showing up at 6:05 or 6:09. So they'd fine them. So here's what they did. Here's the data from this study. They did that for half the group and not for the other half. So you can see, they had baseline data for the first 5 weeks, it was about the same. And then this dark line is the line with people who were fined. And what they found is almost right away, the number of people who were getting fined showing up late to pick up their kids doubled. Does that make sense? I think it does. Are you kidding me? $5 and I get to have happy hours with people at work? $5 and I get to not have my kid in the cart when I'm grocery shopping? I'll take that any day. And instead of showing up just 5 minutes late, they're like, I'm going to take the full hour. I'm showing up at 7 o'clock. But here's the thing that then happened. Was he discontinued it, just like they discontinued the incentive for the kids. But here's the thing. It didn't change. Once you make something transactional, it's very hard for it no longer to be transactional. Once you make it extrinsic, it's very hard to bring it back. What incentives and punishments do is they focus us on what's best for me now. And I think what we want is for kids to be focused on what's best for within our community, within my family, within my classroom, and what's best for my future. Even B.F. Skinner said a person who's been punished is not less inclined to behave in a given way. At best, he learns how to avoid punishment. Is that true for us as adults? Sure is. I'm trying to avoid punishment all the time. And in fact, as divided as our country is, we're all in cahoots to make sure that nobody gets caught by police, right? By speeding.
This is what happens for us. Or, as Funky Little Diva says, when I'm in the naughty corner, I don't spend my time thinking about what I've done wrong. I plan how to do it the next time without getting caught. So this all hit home to me with my son Matthew. This is, he was graduating from high school, 2019. I wasn't sure we were gonna make it to this day. He's a kid who, school came really easily to him, right up until about eighth grade. And then I could kind of smell, so you could sniff something was wrong. And it was literal. I woke up in the middle of the night to the smell of something burning. And I rushed outside, I rushed downstairs where the smell's coming from, and there he is, 3 in the morning. He's pulling cookie sheets out with burning paper on them. I'm like, what are you doing? He's like, I've got a project tomorrow, and I'm trying to make it look historical, right? Like, he's trying to brown the paper so it looks old. He never told us about this project. It was his first all-nighter. It turned out to be the first of many. He then went on to high school where he struggled to organize his work. And so he either skipped class, he's ashamed to show up in class without his work done. So he either skipped class or he'd go late, kind of scribble it just at the last minute, scribble it, go in. So what happens in high school when you don't show up on time? You get a detention, right? You get a tardy detention, right? So Matthew got a lot of detentions. But here's the thing, how many detentions would you give him? Or how many times did you ground your child? Or how many times did you do any punishment? And if it isn't working, how many times did you do it before you say, that's a bad idea, I'm not gonna do that anymore? How many times would you do that? How many detentions would you give Matthew before you realize, we should do something else? Five, you got five? Do I have 10? 15, anybody? All right, so Matthew comes to me right, his last week of his senior year, and he says, Dad, I achieved something I didn't think I was ever going to achieve. And I'm thinking, you know, National Honor Society, he's a bright kid, he does well on tests. I thought, you know, maybe he's speaking at graduation, you know, maybe, because, of, you know, people like him. He said, Dad, I hit 500. This is his disciplinary report. Now, here's the thing, so there's a case to be made. I did not even know this existed on the portal. So otherwise, I probably would have been checking it, but I didn't even know. Now take a look. He only served 466 of them. But look at 466 out of 500, that's over 90%. I think it's an A. I think he got an A in detention. But here's the thing, when it's not working, not only do we keep doing it, but we double down on it, don't we? So guess what else happened because he didn't complete all of his tardies? He couldn't go to prom. How are those things related? Like, are they worried he's gonna be late for his date, and so they just wanted to make sure he didn't offend somebody? Right, he couldn't play sports. He couldn't go to Great America with the senior class. All of these things. So we just pile on. I go to parent-teacher conferences. And like it was like two nights a year I had to carry his shame, and it almost felt too heavy for me to carry. How does he carry this every day? I walk in, and his teachers were very nice. What a nice kid. But he's missing all of his missing assignments. He's got a 35% in here. I'm not sure if he's gonna graduate. I'm not sure if he's gonna pass this class. And then finally I'm walking by a classroom door, and the teacher opens it up, and she says, are you Matthew's dad? And I said, yeah. She says, I love Matthew. And I said, who are you? I love Matthew, I love you. How are you? And she says, I'm his detention supervisor. I see him every day. He would do his detentions at lunch. She'd say, I see him every day. And then there's another clue about what's going on, and this is why I think he made it through, is because the teacher still loved him in spite of the fact that he was struggling so much. And she said, I hope it's all right that I bring a little bit of extra lunch for him because he always forgets his lunch. What's upstream for Matthew? Executive functioning problems. Guess what detentions don't solve? executive functioning problems. The tensions, being late is all downstream. Upstream, it's affecting his brain, just wasn't ready yet to manage the demands that were being placed on him. He did get recognized by his peers, I gotta say. In 2011, 3.5 million students were suspended, more than double 1975. Suspension worked, but shouldn't that number go down? Isn't suspension a deterrent? Isn't it supposed to go down? What's the worst punishment we have in society? Prison, right? So prison's gotta work, doesn't it? We sure put enough people in prison? We sure spend enough money on prison? So it's gotta work. There's a 76.6% five-year recidivism rate following release from state prison. Three-quarters of the people who have experienced our worst punishment end up going back and being incarcerated again. There must be more to the story. And there is. What I want to say is it's not all or nothing. But the problem is we've bought into this idea that when kids struggle, there's got to be a punishment or an incentive to get them out of it. And I just want to begin to take a look. What are the limitations and what's the impact of our doing this? I think we need to be thoughtful and go into these moments with our eyes wide open. Remember, this all started with based on animal behavior. So the leading voice, the leading researcher in primate research, Franz De Waal, says neuroscience is breaking open the black box to look inside the brain, offering accounts of how animals solve problems that rely less and less on the learning theories of the past. It doesn't even apply to animal learning theory, is what he's saying. Behaviorism is dying a slow death, lifting its head only now and then to feebly try putting a brake on these developments. What I hope we can begin doing is figuring out how do we marry the art with the science and our practice. And it doesn't mean we do nothing. It just means we do things differently when our kids are struggling the most. What it means is we look upstream. I want to think about three different ways to look upstream. One is through emotional regulation. One is understanding kids' challenges through the lens of development. And the other is something that I think we have really, is our greatest untapped resource, which is embedding kids in healthy communities. All right, so emotional regulation. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to think about the last time you lost your temper. What did you look like? What did you sound like? What dumb thing did you do or say? Am I the only one who looks bad when I lose my temper? We say and do some pretty mean and hurtful things, don't we? So why is it we're good people, we're bright people? Why is it that in these moments, we can do things that are either harmful for ourselves or harmful to other people? And the answer, remember I said it was 150 years ago, is Phineas Gage. Phineas Gage told us a lot about understanding behavior problems. He was not a scientist. He was not a doctor. He actually worked on the railroad in Vermont. And his job, you know, Vermont's hilly, so they needed to blow holes in the side of the mountain to lay flat tracks, right? So they would drill a hole. He'd put some explosive in, and then he'd put rocks and things down, he'd tamp it down, he'd step away, light it, blow up a hole in the side of the mountain, and then they'd lay some more tracks. Well, Gage had a very, very bad day one day, and he was tamping it down, and it must have caught a spark that ignited the explosive, and this tamping rod shot out, and he was leaning over it, and it went underneath his chin and then out the top of his head and landed 80 feet away. And he was bloody and his brains were kind of all over the place. It was an ugly situation and they put him, he was still able to get up after he was done. He was able to get up. They got him to a carriage. They put him on a carriage and they got him into town. He made almost a full recovery when he was all done, full physical recovery. It's amazing what he was able to do. People were shocked. He had lost his left eye, but that was about it. He looked like the same guy. And yet, this is the thing that happened. It went through his prefrontal cortex. He had all of his, all the different parts of the different lobes of the brain were working fine, except this prefrontal cortex. And here's what they found, even though he looked like the same guy. His doctor described Gage as fitful, irreverent, indulging at times in the grossest profanity, capricious and vacillating, being radically changed so decidedly that his friends and acquaintances said he's no longer Gage, he couldn't keep a job. You blow up at people. And I'll tell you what, when my temper gets the best of me, I could be described as fitful and irreverent. In fact, there are times when I indulge in the grossest profanity. And you guys might say, oh my gosh, that couldn't be the guy who spoke to us about emotional regulation. It doesn't even look like the same guy. Imagine if we had videos of all of ourselves in our worst moments. It wouldn't look good. And so what happens, what we know, and what we've known for over 150 years, is this part of our brain right here impacts all these things, our ability to manage our impulses, our emotional regulation, our ability to initiate tasks, to persist, to stay with stuff that's hard, to transition, especially from a non-preferred, from a preferred task to a non-preferred task. Empathy, their ability to say, to focus and have attention, your ability to plan. Matthew struggled with all these things. When you think about your child in their worst moment, my guess is that it shows up in one of these areas. And so behavior problems are about brain development, not motivation. It's about this part of their brain. The myth is that we're primarily rational beings. We're not rational beings, we're survival beings. And so our brain is built for survival. There's the cortex, that's the green part. There's the limbic system, that's kind of the center of the brain. And then there's the brainstem, and they each have different functions. The cortex is that part of our brain that is rational. That's the part of our brain that we want kids to be able to solve their best problems, to be able to use to problem solve with their siblings, to get their homework done, right? To benefit from the instruction of their teachers. The limbic system is really their alarm system. And our limbic system tells us, am I safe, am I not safe? And if I'm safe, I'm good, I can engage in whatever I need to engage in. But if I'm not safe, it triggers our brainstem to trigger our stress response. Does this make sense? So stress then pushes us into the lower parts of our brain. Stress enacts our stress response, which is our fight, flight, or freeze response. And in these moments, when our stress response is triggered, we lose some very, very important things. Think about the last time you melted down. My guess is we didn't have access to any of these things. I have been married to my wife for over 30 years. I don't know how she's made it this long, because I'll tell you what, never in any of those arguments that we've had, and we've had some arguments, believe it or not, have I said, hey, honey, I'm doing all the talking. Let me listen to you. I wish I said that. Hey, I can be flexible. Let's do it your way this time. That doesn't come out of my mouth, right? Oh my gosh, I just noticed my tone of voice is really condescending. That must be really annoying to you. No, that stuff doesn't come out of my mouth. I want to be that guy. But I don't have access to that part of my brain. Neither do you in these moments. Neither do your kids. Our language changes. Have you ever been so upset that you can't find the words or you just can't speak? Or, if you're like me, the only words you can think of are four letters long, right? And you gotta feel like you gotta yell them in order for people to understand them. Or you're in an argument, and you're like, oh, I shouldn't do that, I shouldn't do that, I shouldn't do that, and then sure enough, you do it, and you shouldn't have done it. It's that impulsivity that happens. These are also the tools that kids need to learn, at home and at school. And the thing that drives us nuts is, what do we ask kids to do when they're struggling? Listen to me, right? Come up with another solution to this. The world doesn't rotate around you. It's your sister's turn to do this. You need to take the perspective of other people. Memory, eyewitness testimony is remarkably bad because we can't encode things in the cortex because we don't have access to the cortex. Tell me what happened, and they don't tell you what happened, or they scream about it, right? Stop doing that. They can't have access to these things any more than we can when we're struggling, when we're melting down. I'm not saying that we shouldn't ask them to do these things. not when their brain is in lower brain, right? So what do we do about this? There's a guy, he wrote a book called Self-Reg, Stuart Shanker. If you're interested in this and digging deeper, I really like his work. All of his work for his entire career has been on self-regulation, helping kids learn self-regulation. And he talks about moving from misbehavior to understanding it as stress behavior. What he says is there are five domains of stress. The first is biological. Anybody else get hangry? Anybody else get really cranky when they're tired? Like, I am such a bad dad at 9:30 at night. I'm much better at 9:30 in the morning. My kids never see me at 9:30 in the morning. They've got no idea what a great father they've got, right? They only see the mean 9:30 dad. Then there's emotional. Our kids are constantly experiencing emotions for the first time. They're experiencing the intensity of emotions for the first time, and that causes quite a bit of stress. There's cognitive stress. There's cognitive stress that's happening for you guys right now. You're trying to listen, you're trying to remember things, you're trying to think about what's going on for my kids at home, or what I wonder what's happening, or what am I gonna do about at work tomorrow morning. All of these things are going on, and it's exhausting. We all understand social stress, because that's often the thing that is most upsetting for us, is when there's a chat, when in some ways our social relationships are hurting. And then finally, there's pro-social stress. And I never heard about this before, but it makes sense. Pro-social stress is when we've got to make a decision between whether I do something for myself or whether I do something for other people. If I get a cookie, do I share it with my little brother? In which case, I'm frustrated that I didn't eat the whole thing, or do I keep it? And then I feel guilty, right? And so there's this pro-social stress that are happening. And when we think about kids in school, how many of these stresses show up? All of them. And I gotta say, when you think about staff at school, guess what? All of these show up. When we're at home and I need a snack or I need a nap, I can take it, right? If I need a cognitive break, I can close my computer and I'm good. I can take these breaks, right? We can't do that. So I wanna dive into cognitive stress a little bit just to show you how this shows up. Well, first of all, have you ever lost your temper, shut down, or avoided something and not been stressed? I always think it's someone else's fault, but really, there are times that I can handle stressful things pretty well, and other times when I really struggle, and it's always because there's another stress. All right, so here I want to just raise a hand. How many of you are lazy or unmotivated? We got one. Thank you, two. We got a couple? It's okay. I'm going to find out in just about 30 seconds anyways. I'm going to determine which ones of you are lazy and unmotivated. You ready? Here we go. I want you to solve this problem. A bat and a ball together cost $1.10. The bat costs $1 more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? Raise your hand. Don't shout it out. Raise your hand when you've got it. Raise your hand up high so I can see it. All right, now raise your hand if you said 10 cents. Lazy, are you kidding me? Did you check your work? Don't we tell kids to check their work? If you said 10 cents, if the bat cost $1 more than the ball, if the ball cost 10 cents, the bat cost $1.10, what's a 10 cents on $1.10? It's $1.20. You didn't check your work. Are you a teacher? You didn't check your work. Oh my goodness. Well, let me just ask this as well. How many of you didn't do it at all? Just like, I'm not doing this. Raise your hand. We had a couple. Right? Lazy. I'm telling you, lazy. Here's the thing. You're not lazy. You're not unmotivated. And you're in good company because half of Harvard graduates and MIT graduates got this wrong too. You're not alone, right? But here's the thing, and you're not lazy, because our brain works by the law of least effort. I find this fascinating. What they did was they began giving these problems to people in a laboratory. And one of the things that we know is that when people are stress, when people are, when their stress response is triggered, our eyes dilate, our pupils dilate. And so what they did was they watched to see when their pupils dilated. And when their pupils dilated, they could, within a split second, they could predict whether they were either going to respond inaccurately or give up, right? So this is the interesting thing. What they talked about is this inverted V curve, which means that as we're going up, we work as hard as we can, but at some point we get distressed and we just shut it all down. We shut all of our energy down because our brains are built for survival, remember. And we need to have a little bit left in the tank. If I ask you to get down and give me as many push-ups as you can, you guys are a fit group, I'll bet you guys could do 25, 30 push-ups like that, right? But at some point you'd be like, I can't do it anymore. But then what if I came up and I said, I'll give you $1 million for every additional push-up? I'll bet you could do some more push-ups, right? You could probably crank out at least 3 or 4 more. So this is what our brain does. Our brain always wants to keep a little bit in reserve. Wants to make sure that we've got enough energy that in case of a crisis, we can act. And the same thing is true for our brain. We don't want to deplete all of the energy that's in our brain, because if we do, we're not going to be able to think straight if there is an emergency that threatens our lives. What they talk about is this intolerable peak. And there's our hypothalamus is the thing that measures how much energy we have left in our brain. It's like our gas gauge that goes off before you run out of gas, right? It says, lights up when you're about to run out of gas. It wouldn't be that helpful if it lit up after you ran out of gas. And our bodies do the same thing. Our limbic system, our alarm system goes off and says, you've got to stop it right now because there's not enough left in the tank. And so the more depleted we are, I'll bet you if I gave that to you first thing in the morning, more of you would have gotten it, right? So the more depleted we are, the quicker we are to get here. At the end of in the morning, I can do hours of email, but after a long, stressful day, once I'm up here, it doesn't take long before I'm like, I can't do email anymore. And so students, our kids, are more vulnerable to the intolerable peak if they've got attention problems, if they're stressed at home, if they're slower processing, if they're slower to develop, they experience discrimination or poverty, all of these things. And so a lot of kids walk into school right about here, and then they shut it down. All of a sudden, their brains shut down. And what is it? And how do we respond when we shut down? Well, it can look like this, right? But it can also look like this. Oppositional behavior. It's like, no, I'm not doing it anymore. You can't make me do this anymore. Daydreaming. Zoning out. And so what do? We punish kids for this, don't we? When this stuff shows up. We call them lazy, don't we? Unmotivated. We scare them about what's going to happen for their future if they can't persist through a task. So the good news is Shankar has some strategies for what do we do about this? How do we help kids when we know that they continue to crash, when they continue to struggle? The first is we reframe it. Can we shift from saying, oh, this is misbehavior, to stress behavior? He likes to call it limbic braking instead of laziness. And then we've got to recognize what's causing the stress. It's hard to do this at night. This is a bad time for you guys all to be sitting and listening, right? So I'm sorry, all right? But it's hard to get you all together at 9 in the morning. So we know that that's hard. There are times that we're going to see that kids are struggling. Well, if you notice that they're struggling right after they come home from school, maybe they need a break. Maybe there's stress in that break. Maybe they're hungry, right? And then can we reduce the stress? My daughter used to get very hangry, and we finally realized it, and we just started carrying around granola bars. And and it worked, because we were able to reduce that stress in that moment. And then the goal is to help them understand, oh, when I get stressful, when I act up and I struggle, it's because I'm under stress. I wonder what that stress is happening for me. So let's help them reflect on that beforehand. Soon my daughter was taking granola bars herself, right? And then can we just restore? Can we get them something to eat? Can we get them a nap before? Can we get them a break before they start their homework at night? Can we get them, if they struggle with long car rides and they're always irritable on long car rides, can we work in some breaks on the car ride? Whatever it is, let's restore it before, so we can punish or we can see it as stress. And all we got to do then is figure out, how do we help them cope with the stress? Larry Steinberg says the capacity for self-regulation is probably the single most important contributor to achievement, mental health, and social success. If we want our kids to be successful, where we should start is, instead of pushing them and pushing them and pushing them on their homework, is to help them learn how to self-regulate so they can access their best brains for their homework first. I like this quote. Parenting is like driving a car at night. You can only see as far as your headlights, but you can make the whole trip that way. The problem is it's all these moments. There's not any one moment that helps get you, when you help your child regulate, that it's going to be like, oh, now I don't have any regulation problems. It doesn't work that way. But the more we can help them do it, the more we can make progress every single year until they've developed the skills they need to develop. The next is, we need to understand development, because development is a really powerful tool we have as parents, but I think it's something we don't think much about. My friend David Gleason, he coined this term, developmental empathy. I really like this term. He wrote this book, At What Cost? Defending Adolescent Development in Fiercely Competitive Schools. And so here's what developmental empathy is: matching the demands we place on our kids with their brain's development. Not asking them to do more than their brains are able to do. Kind of makes sense, doesn't it? The thing is that our brains, I think 25 is too young. What they're finding is this part of our brain, this prefrontal cortex we talked about before, is not fully developed until their late 20s, early 30s. That means if you've got a 7-year-old, it's still only a quarter of the way developed. And here's the thing, they develop at different rates, just like kids' heights develop in different rates. There are 8th graders who will walk through this hallway and some have facial hair and a body odor like crazy, 6 feet tall. You got other kids you know are still 3 years away from puberty walking right with them, right? But we say, oh, this one just hasn't hit his growth spurt yet. But because the prefrontal cortex, we can't see it, we don't see it that way, right? And so what we do is, when kids struggle with the development of their prefrontal cortex, we begin to punish them, or we try to incentivize them. Would we ever say, hey, listen, I've got a great incentive program so that you can grow facial hair? We wouldn't do that. But why would we? The same thing is happening for their ability to be able to manage the tasks that our prefrontal cortex demands of us. So what happens with stress? There's always stress when the demand is greater than the skills that we have. I'm a terrible singer. That's not a problem, because I don't have to sing very much. If I had to leave you guys in happy birthday, I would not enjoy that. That would be highly stressful for me, right? So this incompatibility causes stress. School has never been more demanding. We're asking kids now, I think for Matthew, we're asking Matthew in 8th grade to do stuff I didn't need to do until I was a junior or senior. And so it's more stressful. And what we need to remember is, everybody's brain develops at its own pace, at its own rate. And development requires failing, doesn't it? We try stuff, and then we fail, and we try again, and we start to get it, and we start to learn. How about when kids are learning how to walk? Do you realize they fall 69 times per hour? Imagine that. And we never call him clumsy, do we? Oh, he's clumsy. He keeps falling. We never do that. What do we say when Matthew isn't completing his work? He's lazy, he's unmotivated. We treat gaps in development as behavior problems. This is one of the things we need to be very, very careful about. Because when older kids fail, we call them lazy or irresponsible or manipulative or immature or selfish or defiant, whatever you name the adjective. When we aren't aware of developments, we can make terrible decisions for our kids. And we punish and shame. That's what happened for Matthew at school. Then he'd come home and he'd get it from me, because I didn't really get it either. He was already peeling shame. The additional shame I was throwing on him, the additional stress I was throwing on him, was not helping. Here's an interesting thing about development, and we were just talking about this. So here's the thing. A kid born on September 1st is a year older than a kid born on August 31st. And what's amazing to me is if we take a look at the ADHD diagnoses by birth date, in August, kids, the youngest kids, our August children, are 34% more likely to have a diagnosis of ADHD than our September kids. Why? Because they're just that much, they're more immature, they can't track things as well, they have more social skills problems, and all of a sudden, here we go. They struggle, and then it starts to compound, and we see it as ADHD. Here's the thing, this is not to say everybody should just hold their kids back. That's not the answer. The answer is, can we begin to see these things through the lens of development? Because everybody's developmental path is unique. Everybody's is. Our physical development and our brain development are both unique. So what we want to do is help them achieve their greatest potential, but always starting with where they're at, not where their classmates are at, not where the other kids on the baseball team are at. And then prepare them for the next step. Whenever we fight development, we lose. So can we nurture development? So Matthew, it was almost like I was watching that prefrontal cortex develop. It's almost like I had an insight into it. He worked for he was an inclusion aide starting his sophomore year for a recreational organization, a recreational camp, NSSRA. The first summer, he showed up late every day. It drove me nuts. The next summer, he'd run around barefoot all the time. The next summer, he'd show up, and half the times he forgot to wear shoes, so they had to send him home. The third summer, he was counselor of the year. It's almost like, can you see how all of a sudden he started getting that brain together? But it's about, his prefrontal cortex was about 4 years off from what schools and what his other peers, most of his peers, were able to do. It just happened slower. Can you imagine how anxious I was sending him off to college when he was still struggling to get his work done in high school? But his brain, I think, kicked in just at the right time, and here he is, his graduation day from high school last June. He made it. It's about development. Anybody else make the gravy at Thanksgiving? I hate making gravy at Thanksgiving, because I'm not sure if I'm doing it right, but this is what I do. I put the butter and the flour in there, and I mix it all up, and then you pour the turkey juices on there. And then someone's carving the turkey, and everybody's sitting down. And what you know when you're making the gravy, is that it takes about 7 to 9 minutes, right? Am I right about that? Somewhere around there, to thicken. But about 5 minutes, I'm always afraid it's not going to thicken, and I just want to start pouring more flour in there to thicken it. And I know I'm going to ruin it. And I think that's what I did with Matthew. I got impatient, I got anxious, and then my anxiety started pushing him in ways that weren't helpful for him. The last one is, can we create communities of belonging? And can we embed kids in communities of belonging? My daughter, Anna, I think she was born with her prefrontal cortex fully intact. That girl had it figured out from an very early age. So she gave me this, I love this. She knows how important it is, community is important for me, and she painted this, and I love the fact that I didn't know she could paint, and I like the picture. But even more, I like her definition of community. Community is the complicated, messy, beautiful fight to simply see each other. Isn't that good? I don't know about your families, but families are complicated, and they're messy. And we gotta fight for them to be healthy, but when we get there, there's real beauty in what we can do as families. And at the end of the day, can we simply see each other? Here's the thing. The data on belonging is really powerful. When we think about our kids' biggest problems, when we think about our school's biggest problems, see how many of these things belonging crosses off the list. Children who are embedded in communities of belonging are more motivated to learn, they perform better academically, they have better attendance, they engage in less misconduct, they're healthier, they have higher self-esteem and better mental health. Not bad, right? And it's, study of 12,000 teenagers found that the most powerful protective factors for every form of adolescent risk behavior, emotional distress, drug abuse, violence, and suicidality. What is it? Their sense of belonging at school and at home. This sense of belonging at home is essential, and it's important that we have it at school as well. Because what happens is when we talk about stress, there are really three different kinds of stress. Positive stress is when you have to get up and you've got to give a toast at a wedding or something, right? And it's stressful for a while, and then it's over, and your stress response goes back to normal. Then there's tolerable stress. And that's when we've experienced loss or grief. We have an illness or injury that lasts, right? It lasts for several months, but eventually it starts getting better. And then finally there's toxic stress. That stress that continually, it's never stopping. And it's continuing to push our stress response system beyond what it's able to manage. But take a look. For tolerable and toxic stress, how do we cope with it? Positive relationships buffer stress, period. What they do when we're embedded in families and we're embedded in classrooms where there's emotional connection, it is like it's like the connective tissue for our mental health. It means that we can struggle and we know that there are people there that are going to support us. And here's the thing. We have all the resources we need. We've got our families and we've got our classrooms and schools. That's why this is so important. Family connections make all the difference in a child's life. I want to talk about a little research from Google. They wanted to figure out how teams work well together. What teams work best together? I thought this was fascinating. What makes teams effective? And they looked at all sorts of things. Is there diversity? How do they socialize outside of work? Do they have an agenda? All of these things. But what they found is great teams have two qualities. The first is equal airtime. Everybody's voice matters. Everybody got about the same amount of time to talk. And the second is attunement. They knew one another's stories. They could read one another. They could see when someone else was stressed, and they'd say, what's bothering you about this meeting, or is everything okay? Right? We know one another. This is the basis for psychological safety. Amy Edmondson, she's a Harvard researcher, and she coined the term psychological safety. And what psychological safety is this belief by all members of a family that it's okay to take a risk here. And if I take a risk, I won't be embarrassed or shamed or humiliated. And a climate in which everyone can feel be themselves. But that's psychological safety. So I think that great families have these same qualities. Everybody has a voice. Everybody's voice matters. And we're attuned to one another. I want to just put a little plug in for family dinners, because I think family dinners are hard to do. You know when we started having family dinners? COVID was the best thing for us for family dinners. We had gone years without family dinners, and all of a sudden, every night for 4 months, and what a difference it made for us. And I'm not saying it has to be family dinners. If one of you works late at night, it can be breakfast time. It can be making sure that there's a little bit of time every day when the family is connecting. That's the work. And what they find is when families invest in that time, and they've done this research with family dinners, is kids' vocabulary, achievement, and reading go up. And their empathy and social skills go up. Why? Because they're learning all of these things from us in their interactions with us. This strengthens our sense of who we are. And there's the reduced incidence of suicide, substance abuse, depression, aggression, and early sexual behavior in kids. Not a bad result, right? So, when I talk about grace, I'm not talking about it being a religious thing, but I love what grace does. Because typically what grace does is people, it's a moment of mindfulness, isn't it? We quiet everything. Oftentimes, people will close their eyes. They'll express gratitude. Sometimes we hold hands and we touch. What we know is all of these things trigger all sorts of very positive neurotransmitters in our brains that help us be our best selves. Family dinners are not about the broccoli, right? It's about all of these other things that happen when we get together. And here's the thing, our children are watching. They're watching how we interact with them. They're watching how we engage with them and with our spouses. This is how they learn. And they're listening to what we're saying. One of the things that I think is really challenging for parents these days is that the message that most parents think they're sending are not the messages kids are hearing. 90% of parents report that their top priority for their child is that they're caring people. What are their kids hearing? 81% of children report that their parents value achievement and happiness over caring. Here's what happens. When they're caring to their little brother, we say, oh, that's so nice. When they come home with a B, you are not leaving this house until you get that up to an A. Right? They notice how strongly we respond to issues related to achievement. And then finally, we need to be able to expand our lives. Here's the thing. All of our lives are a rhythm. We work 5 days and then we hopefully have a weekend, right? We sleep and then we work and then we sleep again. There's a rhythm of being able to contracting is the sleep, and then we expand to be able to work hard and make dinner and do all the things we need to do. Football teams, they come together at the beginning of the game. They play the first half, and if you like the Bears, then they have to really struggle with what to do the second half. But we have a halftime where we rest and we reflect, and then they go out and play again, and then they come together at the end of the game. There's this rhythm to what happens. And that rhythm is very important because we need to be able to have those moments of contraction in order to expand, don't we? If I said, hey, listen, you are gonna be much more effective if you don't sleep all week, sleep on the weekend, that wouldn't work so well, right? Because we need that rhythm. But here's the thing, children's lives have been expanding for the last several decades. And they're not contracting. And as parents, the same thing is true, isn't it? You're constantly trying to figure out, okay, which travel team practices today, and do you need your helmet or do you need your shin pads, right? How are we gonna get this kid there, and then we gotta do the homework, and we gotta get the homework done, and then we've gotta get the snacks for the football for the halftime. We gotta get our kid to ballet, and then another one to music lessons. We continue to expand everybody's life. And it's taking a toll on all of us. I like this story by Blair Braverman. She was a dog musher in Alaska. And she said, if I strap my dogs into their harnesses at the beginning of the race, they will just run for hours. They'll run for about 40 or 50 miles, but then they'll collapse. She said, unfortunately, many of our races are over 100 miles. 500 miles. The Iditarod is over 1,000 miles. She said, so what we do is we run for 4 hours, and then we rest, and we eat, and we get warm, and we care for each other for 2 hours, and then we run again. And we can run forever that way. But the problem with us, and for our kids, and for our own lives, is we're no longer resting for that 2 hours. These breaks are essential. Take a look, this is you may be able to relate to this. The top are brain scans of people when there's not a break between meetings. So the blue is like pretty relaxed, open brains. And then the red, the orange, and the yellow are stressed brains. Look at what happens when there's no break. But look what happens when we put a break in. We can meet forever that way, right? And yet we don't take the 10 minutes between meetings. same thing is true for kids. Take a look. These are all, except 4 million kids in Denmark. They took a look at what happens when we give the test at different times a day. As they get cognitively more tired, as you guys were solving that problem today, right? What happens is they go from, it goes progressively down, but there's a bump here, isn't there? And there's a bump here. Why did those go up? They didn't get up to baseline, but why did they go up? Because they put a break in, about a 10-minute break. This may not look like a big bump, but it's the same effect as if they got three extra weeks of instruction, which is a pretty big bump. So here's the thing, something really unexpected happened during COVID in our high-functioning school districts, or our high-functioning kids. Sonia Luthar did the research on this. She's been doing research on the high-functioning schools, high-achieving schools for years. She said the well-being of these students actually improved. As classes and exams were canceled, grading moved to pass-fail, and extracurricular activity ceased, they reported lower levels of stress and anxiety and depression compared with 2019. I'm not saying they were happy. We don't like to have these things canceled. But like I said, we started having family dinners together. Instead of saying, what the homework do you have tonight? We said, what movie are we going to watch tonight? And all of a sudden, the kids who are most stressed became less stressed. Kids would come in, I'm a psychologist, so I'd meet with kids and they'd say, I hate remote school. I hate remote learning. But I love the fact I don't have homework. All of a sudden, when they come home, the first question isn't what homework do you have to do? And when are you going to do it? Kids started getting more sleep, especially our high school kids. My daughter, she was doing statistics as a senior at Evanston Township High School. And one of the interesting things is every year they took statistics on how much kids slept. And that's how they would do all their statistical analysis. They've got decades worth of research on how long kids were sleeping. What they found is that during COVID, kids were getting almost an hour more sleep at night. Does that make a difference? It absolutely does if you care about symptoms of ADHD, obesity, behavior problems, academic skills, and social skills. All are impacted by that. And again, I think there's a bit of a smoking gun when we think about our kids and the struggles that they're having, because I don't have it here. Between 1980 and 2010, kids on average are sleeping an hour less. And we get surprised when we begin seeing this. Like we talked about before, kids weren't overscheduled all of a sudden, and neither were we. And so all of a sudden, we had a little break. Kids started doing a little bit better, being able to catch their breath a little bit more. I'm not saying they liked it, I'm not saying we liked it, but I am saying we've got to follow the data a little bit, and then we blew it. We came back in the fall of 2020, so we got to make up for all that lost remote work, right? And these improvements were short-lived. Beginning in the fall of 2020, as schoolwork ramped back up, the mental health of adolescents returned to pre-pandemic levels or worse. Went right back. You know, if I told my wife that I was going to have a schedule like many of our high schoolers have schedules, she wouldn't like that. But hey, I tell you what, I'm gonna wake up at 5:30 in the morning. I'm gonna swim for 2 hours with a swim team. I'm gonna be on a senior swim team, and then I'm gonna go to work, and I'm gonna eat my lunch while I'm working, and then I'm gonna be in a garage band with my buddies, and we're gonna practice every afternoon until about 7 o'clock. I'm gonna miss dinner, but I'll just warm something up. I'll take it into the den, and then I'll eat while I'm finishing up my work for the night. I'll go to bed around midnight or 1 o'clock. What would she tell me? She'd say, there'll be some divorce papers waiting for you in that den of yours soon, right? She's like, that's not healthy. And yet, these are the kids that we hold up as the kids who are most successful, the ones in 5 AP classes and the captain of the soccer team. And they're in the school play, starring role. We are ramping this up like crazy. COVID shined a light on our children and our community. David Foster Wallace, he gave the commencement address at Kenyon College in 2005. And he told the story He said there are these two young fish swimming along, and they happen to meet an older fish swimming the other way who nods at them and says, "Morning, boys, how's the water?" And the two young fish swim on for a bit, and eventually one of them looks over at the other and goes, "What the hell's water?" And he says the immediate point of the fish story is the most obvious, ubiquitous, important realities are often the hardest to see and talk about. And the pressure we're putting on our kids is hard for us to talk about. The pressure kids put on themselves, hard for us to talk about. Tragically, David Foster Wallace took his own life 3 years after giving that commencement address. Here's the thing. We got out of that for a little bit, and we began to see the kids started getting better. I'm not saying we shut everything down, but I am saying, can we learn some lessons as parents about the pressure we're putting on kids? And in their hardest moments, can we help them regulate instead of punish them? Can we see that through the lens of development? And can we embed them in healthy communities? I'm going to end with one story about my mom. We were we had a cabin in the Adirondack Mountains at the end of a long lake. No houses around, and but a lot of canoers would canoe by. And it was I was eight years old. My mom was heading off to, we were all heading off to bed. It was still a little bit light out because it was summer. And my mom went and she turned on the floodlights outside of the house. I'm like, "Mom, what are you doing? You're supposed to turn the lights off when you go to bed." And she said, "I want to be sure if there's someone out there who needs help, if they know that we're here. So, go to bed." But about a month later, about midnight, there's a pounding on the door. My mom gets up, and I'm kind of hiding behind her. She comes and opens the door, and there's this big, rough-looking guy. He's got his arm around his 11-year-old daughter. She's got her hand over her eye. And he said, we got into camp late, and I was making a fire really quickly, and I was snapping wood over my knee, and I think a splinter went into my daughter's eye, and I think she lost her vision. So my mom piles him into the station wagon and takes him to the medical center about an hour and a half away. They come back hours later. The sun is just coming up. The doctor spared her eye. They went back and they canoed back to their place. And later that day, we saw them canoeing down towards us. And they stopped at our dock and they took all of their camping equipment out and they brought it up and put it on our deck. And they said, "We want you to have this. We are so grateful for all that you did for us. And we are never camping again." We're not going to need that. But the message was really important to me. When our kids are in their hardest moments, is our light on? Or are we rejecting? Are we punishing and shaming in those moments? Can we keep our light on? But that's our work. It's our work in schools.